as we're gradually moving back to opening schools and businesses and, of course, our in-person interactions, I want to remind you, this is all time with cold and flu season getting going. Staying hydrated is key to helping your body deal with the added stress and with the upcoming flu season. My regular fans have heard me talk about a product called Hydrolyte for a long time now. It's an amazing rapid rehydration drink. It's a mix that, well, we're obsessed with here. I'm excited to announce they've just released Hydrolyte Plus Immunity, just in time for cold and flu season. Hydrolyte Plus Immunity starts with their fast-absorbing electrolytes and adds a host of immune-boosting ingredients. Each single-serve, easy-pour drink mix contains 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C and 300 milligrams of elderberry extract, creates what is hopefully immune-boosting formula that's high in antioxidants and zinc. Combining this with Hydrolyte's 7 key electrolytes, it's a fantastic way to stay proactive and properly hydrated. Hydrolyte Plus Immunity comes in convenient, easy-to-pour powder sticks that rapidly dissolve in water and make a great tasting drink that has 75% less sugar than your typical sports drink. It uses all natural flavors and it is gluten-free, dairy-free, caffeine-free, non-GMO, and it is vegan. And you can find Hydrolyte Plus by visiting hydrolyte.com/Dr. Drew. Again, that's hydrolyte.com/DRDRW. And be sure to use our code DrDrew25 at checkout for a special discount. Well, I too have struggled with GI issues over the years. I have something called Lynch syndrome. So gut health is extremely important to me. And while gut health awareness has increased, it's led to a wellness trend that's inspired a host of questionable marketing and some false claims. Now, you've seen the word probiotic attached to all kinds of supplements, drinks, even more. They may claim to deliver the healthy microorganisms our gut needs for proper function, but all too often the promises are in fact too good to be true. Thankfully, I became aware of a company called Seed and their flagship product, the Daily Symbiotic. Seed's Daily Symbiotic offers 24 clinically researched strains of microorganisms in a single dose. These strains support gut health and can improve regularity and relieve bloating, sometimes within as little as 24 to 48 hours. To me, what really sets Seed's Daily Symbiotic apart is the delivery system. While some products may offer the right strains, they're fragile, they rarely survive the trip through the gut, doesn't get where it needs to go, but Seed uses a capsule-in-capsule design that helps ensure the probiotic reaches your colon, which is where they often are needed. I've been taking Seed's Daily Symbiotic, and I really encourage you to check out their story and the science behind what they do. To try it for yourself, just go to seed.com/Dr. Drew. Use code DrDrew20 for 15% off your first month of Daily Symbiotic. That is seed.com/Dr. Drew. Use code DrDrew20. This pandemic began, we were not sure how it spread. Everyone began wearing masks and using hand sanitizers. Great ways to slow the spread, but a lot of people still get sick. I can personally attest to that. We now know that COVID-19 spreads via aerosols and droplets from the nose and mouth. And I've been thinking about this for a while. Why aren't we also sanitizing the nose and mouth, killing the virus directly at the place where it spreads? Why weren't more doctors thinking about this? Well, some doctors have done the research. Wish I discovered it sooner. That's why I'm excited to tell you about Halodyne. It's an FDA-registered antiseptic for the nose and mouth that's proven to eliminate 99.99% of the virus that causes COVID-19 in just 15 seconds. That's right. It's created by a team of clinicians with decades of experience in antiviral treatments, initially created to protect healthcare workers. These are smart scientists. And it's a great product that also eliminates many other viruses and infecting particles. I'm using both their nasal antiseptic swab and their oral spray to help protect those around me, and you should be too. For others and for yourself, whether you're hopping on a 3-hour flight, always use it there, visiting grandparents or attending a meeting that you can't miss, Halodyne's family of oral and nasal antiseptics give you the safe, easy, on-the-go antiviral protection for up to 4 hours. I encourage you to try Halodyne at Halodyne.com today. My listeners get 10% off with the discount code Dr. Drew. That is Halodyne.com, discount code DRDREW. So obvious, it just makes sense. Stop the virus before it spreads and gets in your body with Halodyne. This pandemic began, we were...
Hey, everyone. It's a dose of Dr. Drew.
Everybody's a blue mic, too. So
we want to give a shout out to our sponsors at the top.
Okay.
Go for ahead. Everybody on Clubhouse as well.
Right. I don't know if you
just tell them who they are. Let's give a little.
So, are you hearing something here, Susan? I'm getting feedback.
Sorry, that's me.
All right. So Blue Mike, of course, they're the reason I'm able to have the sound as good as I do. And our friend with the IWAN, which you know I'm obsessed about, the UVC light. And Halodyne helps us use the masks more effectively. Why more of us aren't doing that or why that isn't being more strongly advocated, I don't know. But it should be. And of course, Hydrolite and finally Seed, which I take every single day.
You do, and it works. Mm-hmm.
So what we're doing today, I'm watching you guys on the restream, but I've got a little audience together on Clubhouse, and we're going to bring some of the Clubhouse folks up out of the audience if they're interested to be the phone calls to call in on the show if that's what they want to do. But right now, I'm just looking at your guys' notes on the restream, and I'm wondering what everyone is thinking these days. What stuff is worrying you guys? How long do COVID symptoms last? I had them for 12 weeks. I had them for 10 weeks. And some people have them for months and months and months. So it can go on. Yes.
I want to talk about schools opening up.
Okay.
And I want to talk about how we're mandating that everybody gets vaccinated before the schools open up,
only LA Unified.
Right. And if somebody's young and doesn't have comorbidities, mm-hmm. why does that have to be?
It doesn't, but it is a position that the LA Unified School District's teachers union has elected to adopt. It makes no sense based on science. But I don't blame teachers for being scared in the sense that we have pummeled everyone with panic porn for a year, and the bureaucratic response in Southern California has been so confusing that the teachers are listening to the state, the county, the federal government, their teachers union, the school district. I mean, every one of those bureaucracies is saying something completely different to them. So of course they're nervous and concerned. I don't blame them. I really don't blame them. The union, as a leadership, has taken very bizarre positions, saying things like, we have to get out of the purple zone, which is something that Los Angeles will never stay out of until they adopt and finally Governor Newsom has recognized that, and he is going to change the standards for getting out of the purple zone, which are arbitrary in the first place. There's no science to dictate that at all. It's perfectly arbitrary. And fine, then if he moves the goalpost, then we're able to get out. The problem is we have 10 million people. San Francisco with 800,000 people, Long Beach with a few hundred thousand people, they're able to get out. But when you have over 10 million people, you can't, there are little fires that emerge all over the place that keep pushing us back into the purple zone. Now, being vaccinated, the international, no country other than the United States that I could find closed their schools for more than 2 weeks. So there is thousands of, certainly hundreds, if not thousands, of scientific studies on school children and transmission. And every study finds the same thing. There's essentially no transmission amongst children, almost no transmission from children to teachers. Teacher-to-teacher transmission occurs, and teacher-to-student occurred. But it was rare. So if you add now vaccine into that, there's just no reason to hold back.
Say the teacher's 25 or 30 and they are like our kids' age, and if they get COVID, they're just, and you might want to explain this to the Clubhouse people, the question is, why would they need a vaccine?
Well, they don't need a vaccine, but the teachers union is requiring it as a condition for going
back to
school.
Explain it to the Clubhouse people. And explain that Clubhouse people are on our show right now.
Clubhouse, we have a little audience at Clubhouse, folks that are kind of listening in as I chat here. We are, for those of you on Clubhouse, if you want to come out of the audience and talk to me, just raise your hand. But by raising your hand, you are agreeing to be on this stream we're doing right now. We're streaming on YouTube, Twitch,
all the links on Dr. Drew TV,
Periscope, and you can find them all at drdrew.tv. So no one is raising their hand, Susan, which is why I've not been talking.
Well, maybe they will. But just explain when I ask a question, what the question is.
You have to be specific what it is you want.
Why do the young people have to get a vaccine before we can open? Why can't we just vaccinate people that need it?
Which is a rational position, but not one that the LA Unified School District has adopted.
Okay.
So you have the teachers union at the LA Unified School District. Okay. They have taken the position that everyone that wants a vaccine has to be able to get it, and they have to be administered before they will consider opening schools. Okay, Kent wants to talk, so let's talk to Kent. Hold on. And I see Matthias also. I'll see you. I'll get you in a second. Hi, Kent. What's going on?
Dr. Drew.
Hey, man.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fantastic. So I'm 53. I have not been vaccinated and quite honestly don't plan on getting vaccinated. But I do have a question about the Johnson & Johnson vaccination and what you know about it in comparison to the Moderna and the Pfizer.
So Johnson & Johnson is a more traditional platform. It's a live attenuated adenovirus, a cold virus, much like this is what they do for the flu, essentially. And it's obviously been altered to produce spike proteins. The spike proteins are the thing that allows the coronavirus to attach to our body, get in our system. And so it's very effective in preventing severe disease. Hospitalization and death was 100% reduced. Did not do that great against moderate COVID, which was like 60-70%. But they also studied their activity against the South African variant, the N.1351, and it was about 60% against that, which was pretty good. And the Moderna people, I think, are producing I know they're working on a booster to cover that and other variants, so they may actually end up with better coverage. But right now, the J&J looks pretty good, and it's a single vaccine, and it's easy storage. Does that make sense?
Yes, thank you for that. I appreciate it.
You betcha. Thank you for the question. Oh, I can't. My phone is such a... and let's see. Matthias's hand is up here. If you put your hand up and want to chat, you agree to go on the stream here with me. So here we go. Is it Matthias? Is that how you pronounce your name?
Nicholas, it's Matthäus.
Matthäus. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, first of all. I've listened to you since the Loveline days with Adam, and thanks for what you're doing, trying to get out the information the best you can regarding COVID. So I'm one of those people who is really watching the long COVID closely because about 15 years ago at age 30, I got, you know, shingles virus, which shouldn't decimate somebody.
Oh, it can. It can, though. It can,
right.
I've seen older folks, I can think of two cases off the top of my head where they never recovered.
Well, that's what I was going to say. So I was a pro sponsored athlete at the time, pro level, just, you know, doing sponsors with, so very active. I was also a very driven person, not as prolific as yourself, but you've been slowed down by long COVID.
Oh yeah.
I'm somebody 15 years in and a big community of people in the chronic fatigue syndrome community, which was given to me by the Mayo Clinic in 2010. It stopped my life in its tracks. And 15 years in, I ended up homeless.
Oh, my God.
I also followed you a lot in Los Angeles while I was living out of my car.
Ugh.
As you were trying to get out great information, trying to help people who are homeless, which I really appreciate.
How'd you get out?
But, you know, well, I didn't. I'm still semi-homeless, actually, living. I had to come up to Portland after being in the homeless community as somebody who's extremely vulnerable. I also have CKD, so, and AFib, so pretty vulnerable to COVID. I had to be really careful because I'm sharing the bathrooms on the beach in Long Beach, living out of my car, and the community, I respect them all, but a lot of people, as you know, are using drugs, and they're not as conscious of our vulnerability.
And I'm guessing because of your desire to avoid COVID, you don't want to go in any of the shelters.
Yeah, so it's a really nuanced topic.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah.
I'm very lucky. I came from privilege. I have a lot of privilege. I was educated. And to try to get that community to, and other people who want to help, to understand that it's not as easy as just providing, you know, I was able to navigate to a Safe Parking LA program. Even that wasn't you know, very COVID safe. So long story short, I won't get into the nuance of the minutia of that, but I really wanted to talk about and hope you bring light to a highly stigmatized community who has been bashed,
chronic fatigue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, fibromyalgia too. And I don't look the part. I have hypothyroidism. I have osteoporosis. I still look like a fit 45-year-old, but I'm chair bound. Actually, we share some of the same genetics. My mother's a Ashkenazi Jew, and I'm half Greek. But I've noticed, even as you discuss with Adam, your hernia recovery problems, I had the same thing. And right. It's just hard to explain to people that no matter how hard you try, it's not an effort-based thing. You argue with Adam all the time because he's very arrogant about his given robustness.
Right.
It's such, and I don't know what my question is. I'm just happy that you hopefully will bring attention to this topic.
Yeah, oh, happily. Let me see if Anthony Brown is on the thing here. I want to hook you up with him. Is Anthony on the thread here? Because Anthony's very passionate about helping homeless folks, and you're somebody
and
that...
And I was trying to advocate on YouTube and Instagram myself, but again...
But you're somebody that should...
The brain fog.
Yeah, no,
it's so hard.
It's uncanny, right? It's this weird, uncanny thing. It's like a head injury. Yeah. It's like you're not right.
And I went to the Amen Clinic. I had resources to pay, and I spent... I mean, I'm not going to try, but I spent over $400,000 of my own savings. I had that. That's what kept me alive, but I don't have it now. And it can happen to... Imagine starting this process, Dr. Drew,
from zero,
like you did, and you didn't have the resources you had.
Oh, I understand.
You wouldn't have been here.
Oh, listen, I'm very sensitive
to
this.
And I really was... I'm not happy you're going through it. I'm just happy that you're bringing attention to it. And even if it's not the same post-viral malaise that people with chronic fatigue go through, it's just the idea of the compassion towards that community instead of judging them and denigrating them. Honestly,
It is. It's interesting. Have you tried fluvoxamine? Because it really helped me.
Well, it's funny you say that because I've been very lucky to manage my mental health all up till the last 6 months of the pandemic.
Yeah.
But now I am depressed on top of it, which is very controversial because
reasonably,
we get pigeonholed as chronic fatigue people as conversion syndrome or depressed.
Yeah.
But I have a med management person that wants me to try Lexapro. I have to be very careful with, I'm very sensitive to medications, and I've been holding on to it, thinking about trying it, but after seeing the information and watching your interviews about fluvoxamine, I thought maybe it could even have the effect of helping the inflammation off-branded like it's doing for...
Yes, for me.
Yeah.
So, but Lexapro, Prozac is close to Luvox, but Lexapro is not really. So it's really either Luvox or Prozac to get the anti-inflammatory effects. And
really?
I think you'd be...
So Lexapro won't do that. Okay.
Not really. Not nearly as well as the other two. It's not... Right. It's like Zoloft zero. Zoloft not at all. Lexapro not so good. Prozac better, and Lubox optimal.
And I did the genetic test to decide, you know, that would help. I forget the name of the company that would decide my possible interactions with the drug, since I've had drugs aspirin puts me in the hospital.
My God.
So they determined Lexapro. Anyway, I don't want to monopolize your Clubhouse.
Well, listen,
I really just appreciate
it. Send me an email at contact@drdrew.com, and I'm going to try to hook you up with Anthony Brown.
Will come from Om Rider, just like my thing, Om Rider. But I will send, I'll try to reach out and contact.
All right.
And thanks for just doing what you do. I appreciate it.
I appreciate the call. And listen, you're the kind of person that should be able to come out of this were it not for these complex medical issues, right? And so
I would think so.
Yeah. And so it feels like you got to get both going simultaneously, not one or the other. And so I want to try to help with the vocational rehab part.
Can't we send him to Anthony Brown at Anthony at Brown Manor?
I hope you continue to improve. So thank you so much.
Susan, I think I'd rather tell Anthony, you know, what we're doing here and send a welcoming email.
Okay. That email, I'll have to check it. I send it right now.
Yeah, send it right now so Susan sees it. Wow, that is... So what you're hearing is somebody who is medically deteriorating to the point that he used all of his resources and can't get out of the homeless pit because of what's going on medically, where he's wheelchair bound, all this stuff. And so I'm not quite sure all of what's going on medically, but it feels like that needs to be managed to the point where he has some ability to function in the workplace and then find somebody who can help with those kinds of jobs. All right. Wow, that's heavy stuff. Let's see. Okio 25. Weird symptoms completely wiped. It's a horrible virus. Yes, brain fog. Yep. So all of you, what I didn't say is that you should be following Yo Dr. Yo for all the long hauler information. He is keeping people appraised. He's at Twitter and I think YouTube, Susan, is that right? at yo, doctor spelled out the word doctor.
COVIDlonghaulers.com.
COVIDlonghaulers.com is another place to go. And I do believe that there's going to be a lot of information for people like Matthias who have other post-viral syndromes. I think we're going to learn that because of COVID. This is Alyssa. Hi, Alyssa. What's going on? Alyssa?
Thank you so much for hosting this and for having me.
You bet. Let me just state again, everyone that comes on to talk with me from Clubhouse is also being streamed out on YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, and Periscope. Okay.
Good job.
Is that okay with you?
Yeah, absolutely. Right.
Beautiful. Here we are. What's going on?
So I have a question that I just joined the room, so this might be a little bit out of left field. I'm curious, and I know it's a big question, too. I don't think it has a simple answer.
Okay,
but,
here we go. I'm ready.
I know you, initially learned of you from your work. Working with people recovering from addiction. Mm-hmm. And I run a peer support group. Mm-hmm. We're virtual. We're based out of New Jersey, the New Jersey Peer Support Group.
Cool.
We're free. We're accessible. We meet virtually weekly on Zoom. And but, you know, I have aspirations of doing more and reaching more people. And something that I know there's supportive housing for people who have struggled with mental illness and trauma, but something that doesn't exist and I really think should is kind of halfway houses for people recovering from eating disorders or possibly from other mental illnesses.
So your point is extremely well taken. What you're really talking about is residential treatment centers, right? And residential, no?
Well, so residential treatment centers do exist for people with eating disorders, but what I found in my experience, I went to a residential treatment center, actually, and it was very helpful. But what I struggled with was the transition back from treatment going into the real world.
Right.
You know, it's kind of,
okay.
Treatment is kind of
we're kind of splitting, you know, hairs here, and maybe reasonably so. When I think of residential treatment centers, I think of longer, long-term types environments for learning how to live. Right, learning how to live with mental illness, learning how to live with an eating disorder, learning how to live with addiction. Your initial treatment is concluded, and this is the part that transitions you back, you know, helps you transition back to the world, to either a job or a living environment, whatever it might be. And that usually takes a long time, a really long time for people. And there is nothing like that, and there's not enough at the residential level. So we have not enough acute care. And then people are just sort of sent back to the street. And if they're lucky, they find their way to a residential program, of which there are not enough beds. And then there's almost nothing of this intermediate. In fact, I was looking for one yesterday for somebody with a complex psychiatric condition. He's not ill anymore. He just needs help with learning how to live, quite literally. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, exactly. I think, you know, in my experience, the residential programs that I've come in contact with or, you know, had, you know, heard back from friends and other people who have struggled and sought treatment, they were really great at helping them address their issue, but they weren't really great at helping them, as you said, kind of reintegrate and learn how to actually live in the world, hold down a job, you know, interact with family and friends and leave kind of that treatment bubble and also still have an element of support. And it's just something I'm really interested in and passionate about. And it seems like I certainly agree, there's not enough. They're not accessible enough. It's, you know, it's a problem across the board.
And then there's no way to motivate people into those programs because the laws protect, you know, I don't know what they're trying to protect, but they prevent treating professionals from getting people to go where they need to go. So they just go straight to the street. That's where they end up.
Yeah, and so I guess that was kind of my question is I know it's slowly, I'm starting to hear about a few more kind of whatever you'd like to call them, halfway houses, residential treatment centers for people with addiction. helping them kind of reintegrate into the world. But again, few and far between. But I've never encountered anything quite like that for people with eating disorders, or maybe just people with complex trauma or other issues.
Yeah, you're just really talking about general psychiatry, and there's no business model for it. You know what I mean? There's nothing that will cover it, and people, of course, that have those conditions aren't working and need help. So it's all stuff that have you heard the Trieste model?
No, I haven't actually.
It's something they're doing in Italy that they're supposedly going to build in Hollywood here, and it's a kind of a residential model, but it's designed to also include the kinds of stuff you're talking about. Whether or not it will or does or emphasize that remains to be seen. But there are people that are aware that this is a problem and they want to build stuff to try to meet the need. But again, there's no money and there's no business model for it. All the money is going into housing. You know what I mean? It's all, you know, $750,000 condominiums is what are being built, rather than right. some sort of living environment where there's ongoing care.
Yeah, I guess that was kind of my question was, in your opinion, like what is preventing this from happening?
And what's preventing from happening is the government has adopted a policy of, quote, housing first, and that people need to get housing. And if we get them housing, then they'll get better magically, or we can give them treatment once they're in housing. This is just not true. It's a false narrative, and it's failed, and it's been in place for 25 years. How we doing, everybody? Things are getting better? They're getting a lot worse. And there's literally billions of dollars sitting on the sideline being unspent to help people with these conditions that you're talking about. And we could so easily build treatment centers, models that could be lovely and really help in the way you're describing. So please stay on the hunt. We need to do more of this stuff. Susan, can Anthony Brown maybe get on the... No, because we're not taking calls here. Anthony Brown, I need to talk to you later today. We're going to talk about, in fact, what Alyssa was talking about.
I can invite him to Clubhouse. And he can come
yeah,
on.
Yeah, okay, that'd be good if he could.
Let me figure out how to do that.
Yeah. Anthony Brown, go on Clubhouse, the app, and just show up there in the room I'm in.
Let me see if I can do that.
For those of you in Clubhouse, I see you in the audience there. And if you raise your hand, I will bring you up out of the audience. But by raising your hand, you are agreeing to be on this stream we're doing right now simultaneously at YouTube and Facebook and Twitch. And
got a lot of people on there. Woo.
Yeah, the really audience is pretty good size.
Yeah, it's growing. Anyways, thank you for tell them thank you for me.
Yeah, I think they hear you, I think.
No, they can't.
Let's talk to John, and then if we could get Anthony in there, I want him to ring in.
I'd have to yell over this.
John, what's going
Paul's
on?
Paul's here, one of the CEOs.
Hi, John.
Hey, Doc, how's it going?
Good, what's happening?
Thanks for bringing me up.
You bet.
I appreciate it. Dr. Drew, I had a question for you since, you know, you're so active in the mental health space. I've come across a thing called family constellation therapy. And I wanted to get your thoughts on it.
What's it called? Family.
It resolves inheritance.
Wait. What do you call it? Family.
Constellation.
Let's see what that really is.
Yeah.
Yes. Family constellation therapy. There we go. Okay.
A German psychotherapist named Bert Hellinger.
Okay.
It resolves inherited trauma in family systems. And I wanted to get your.
Well, I'm certainly all about, you know, I see nothing but intra-generational transmission of trauma. That's a constant and massive problem. And I'm all about trauma therapies and trauma treatment. So I'm not quite sure what's different about what this is, other than acknowledging that this stuff gets into family systems and stays for 200 years at least. Let's see what she's saying.
Yeah, the idea is that...
Go ahead.
The idea is that trauma stays... Unresolved trauma stays in family systems for seven generations.
Yeah.
And that if it's not resolved, patterns in people out of a system of loyalty, patterns are repeated.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if you see divorce in a family.
Yeah, yeah. No, there's no doubt that this is true. So to me, it just feels like standard therapy. I mean, this is axiomatic to me, which is that trauma is transmitted intergenerationally, and that's that. And that we have this extraordinary capacity or tendency to repeat traumas from our childhood. And of course, if that's how we're wired as humans or how we're constructed neurologically, then that's what's going to happen.
There's a really good book on the subject from a psychologist named Mark Wolin, mm-hmm. and it's called It Didn't Start With You.
Right.
That talks about how these traumas can be resolved, and it just a pretty revolutionary way of taking on the subject. And I'm a vet, so I've personally had a lot of experience with it, and it seems to have helped a lot. But I wanted to.
How is it different than standard just trauma therapies? Other than acknowledging that it's intergenerational,
it's based on Virginia Satir's work on dramatization mm-hmm. of family systems. Mm-hmm. So it's a little on the phenomenological side, where it's a group of people. It's a very group kind of therapy,
group
where
treatment.
People, family dynamics, and then those family dynamics are uncovered and sure. they're resolved. A series of exercises or rituals, if you'd like.
Again, it still sounds like pretty standard work, but not every technique works for everybody. And so if this is something that helped you and helped you in ways that other things can't, that's fantastic. So I'm all for it. I'm enthusiastically endorsing it, John. I will look into it more. I've just got some stuff up on my computer to watch to learn more about it. But intergenerational trauma and treating trauma is what I've been doing for many, many years. It's interesting to me that's become more axiomatic these days. And I remember they used to have a headwind when I would talk about trauma. People would, no, I'm over that. I'm done with that. That's not a big deal. Of course, it's into your wiring. It's into your body. And it has massive, massive effect. I'm looking to see if anyone raised their hand to come up. This is Sandra. Let's see if that's what I asked. Sandra, what's going on?
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm just at work, and I saw your room, so I jumped in.
Ah, here we are. And now you're on a restream.
She's
kind of
quiet, too. You can tell. She's like, okay.
Yeah. Well, she's at work.
Yeah.
So what kind of work are you doing?
I work a corporate healthcare job. So I work with moms who have just recently given birth and help them through their postpartum journey.
Oh, that's cool. That's nice. Is it all done by phone, or do you actually go out and visit them?
I wish I could go visit them, but no, it's all by phone.
Yeah, that's nice. So you're looking for postpartum depression and trying to keep them out of that.
Right, exactly.
And amongst them other things.
To the right resources and make sure they're following up with their appointments.
Great. Cool.
Yeah, so I actually have a question.
Yeah?
I'm going to explain a scenario first, I guess. So my kid's dad is... he has MS. He got diagnosed about 6 years ago.
Yeah.
And his entire life, since he can remember, he has a lot of family trauma from his childhood. He has been diagnosed bipolar, borderline, personality disorder.
Uh-oh.
Lots of stuff. But he's also currently in recovery from alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess my concern with the type of treatment he gets is it's like nobody is looking at the fact that he has all this going on.
Right.
And everybody is treating one problem.
Well, the one thing that would take it all in would be a 12-step recovery program. So he's clearly must not be doing that, because that is where he would have to bring all that to one place and get help and support and, get confronted over stuff that he needs to deal with differently and take care of business where he needs to take care of business. I mean, that's where all that would get sorted out with his sponsor and his treatment group. So, his alcoholism, and he's probably taking other drugs, which is probably why he doesn't go to 12-step. That's free, and it's available everywhere. Now it's available on Zoom 24, it's essentially around the clock. And the fact that he's not doing that is concerning.
Yeah, he's one of those people who, he feels like it's faith-based, and he's not into that.
Yeah, right. It's free, it's free, and it works. What's he not into?
Exactly. No, totally. And it's... right now, as far as I know, he's sober, but I worry about the way that he's being treated as far as his psychness, because it's like, how can you tell the difference between, like, say, aggression?
Yeah.
Is it his mental health, or is it the MS? Because MS can make you aggressive and moody as well.
That's right. Or the medicines he's taking, or trying to not drink alcohol without a recovery program. All those things cause aggression. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Yeah. I mean,
perfect storm, that's what I say.
Yeah. So I don't know. I you're on it. Can you get you know, either a general practitioner or a psychiatrist or somebody that sits in charge of everything and pays attention?
I think that's what we're lacking. Is I don't feel
like you don't have that primary care piece. You understand that you're part of a medical system. You need to get him that.
Yeah, right. Which, you know, we all know, like, you can't make somebody do something, you know, to take
yep.
their own health. But
yep.
I just find that a lot of people in the behavioral health world don't take into account if somebody has a medical issue.
Oh my God, it's a major problem. You're triggering me even by saying that. I spent the first 5 years working in a psychiatric hospital just doing medical evaluations on psychiatric patients. And I would say 20% of the time, I found a medical problem that was either causing or contributing to the psychiatric problem, and another 20% of medical problems caused by the treatment of the psychiatric problems. So about 30-40% of the time, there was something absolutely relevant. And, you know, and of course, if you have a medical problem, you're particularly a brain neurological problem, you're going to be prone to mental health issues. And that has to be very skillfully managed. I mean, that's not okay just to be, you know, seeing all these different, the medical system is making me crazy. COVID has made me see all the weaknesses, and it's really not been a happy thing for me to look at.
Right. No, me too. I've been in healthcare for 12 years, and I've actually worked in behavioral health. I've been at one of our largest behavioral healthcare hospitals, and I've seen so many of the holes, and I'm really validated though by you agreeing with me.
Yeah. Aww. Well, good, because you're right, and you should find what you need, and good luck. Well, he's a complicated case, and I'm sorry he's going through all that. Let me see if Anthony has made it back. In the meantime, I just want to read something that Joe Giannotti sent me. Giannotti, breaking news from Twitter: breaking, California announces a plan to reopen outdoor theme parks and sporting concert events starting April 1st. Sports stadiums can reopen with 20% capacity if a county's in the red tier. Amusement parks can reopen at 15% capacity if red tier. So good, because Orange County will hit the red tier. Good. So the state of California is waking from its slumber or its delusional system that it was stuck in.
I don't see Anthony, so I don't know if he got the memo. Can you explain to him?
Anthony, if you're listening, you go get the Clubhouse app on your phone and just join.
I sent him the link to the room.
And then look for my room. Just look for me sitting
there. But he may be working. You never know.
Yeah. Or he may be in here somewhere and I can't find him.
I can send him a Zoom link and tap him in, but this would be easier.
I've already forgotten what I wanted him for. I wanted him for a couple
the guy,
of things.
The homeless guy.
Not just him, though. I also wanted him for the residential conversation. Yeah. This is the problem.
That's all right. We have lots of people here that want to talk to you.
All right, I'm gonna call Anthony.
And you don't
tomorrow.
Have a ton of. I mean, you could call Anthony, and he could be on the phone.
Yeah, I'll call him tomorrow.
He could all just right, call you on the phone, and we could.
I'm gonna bring up people who raise their hand. And Anthony, if you come on the stream on the Clubhouse, raise your hand. Raise your hand and bring them on up. This is
I'll keep an eye out for him.
Zach, have I already talked to you? Zach?
Yeah.
I didn't speak to you before, did I?
No.
Okay.
No.
Hey, what's going on?
So I grew up in the LA area, in the era where I was able to listen to you and Adam on Loveline,
the era. Yeah. Oh, so that era. When was that era?
Feel old, Drew.
Sounds like was that the Middle Ages or the Renaissance? Which era was that?
Well, long enough that today I'm a licensed therapist and I also teach comedy improv, and I think that show probably played some influence in both those careers.
That is crazy. I feel honored that you followed through. It's quite an interesting combination. I bet they work together all the time, those two skills.
Yeah, for sure. They definitely do. And I think even then, I really was like amazed by the potential of just that show's ability to bring kids in for entertainment and comedy and then slip them vital mental health, sexual health.
That was the idea. That was the idea.
I think it's incredible. And I'd love for you to just like talk about that a little bit.
All right. All right. Thank you for that, Zach. I will do so. It was an accident that I ended up coming on the radio. I didn't have any desire to come on the radio, but I was asked up on a show around in 1984 when one Anthony Fauci was encouraging us young physicians to go out and talk about AIDS. We were just starting to call it AIDS. We didn't have a causative agent yet. We had HTLV, and it was really a crazy history. And I took it very seriously. And I went up to this radio show. I always liked public speaking and I like doing stuff. So I thought, oh, this would be interesting and fun. I'd done a radio broadcast in the past at college, just briefly. And I went up there. I thought, oh, my God, they don't know anything about this. Someone's got to keep talking to them. And they're coming here. They're coming to this radio station and these guys and talking to them. And they're not coming to the clinics. They're not coming and asking me questions. They're coming to FM radio disc jockeys. Now, you have to appreciate that radio at the time was an extremely powerful social. It's almost like sort of the TikTok or something of the time, or Facebook, or this radio was the spot where young people went. It's how you defined yourself. It was the culture you aligned with. And it's when the people that were on the radio opened the phone lines, you wanted to talk to them. So I immediately identified that radio was an important opportunity for me to kind of slip in and keep offering information. By the time Adam came along, we actually had a formal policy we both agreed we were using, which we called it the Gainsburger and the Pill philosophy. And Gainsburger, you will not remember, it was a dog food. Susan, you remember Gainsburger, right? Can you pull up a Gainsburger?
I have a dog. Yeah. That's all I got. He's sniffing urine, though.
Gainsburger that's a prostate sniffing dog, prostate cancer sniffing dog. The Gainsburger was looked like a hamburger, and you sort of break it up and put it in. Now we might say maybe it's some turkey or something. So Adam was the Gainsburger. I was the pill. If you wanted a dog to take the pill, you couldn't shove the pill in its mouth every day. You'd have to get it to swallow it with peanut butter or Gainsburger. So I was the pill. Adam was the Gainsburger. Because I was wrapped in Gainsburger, you would take the pill is where we thought
about
it.
You're still the pill.
I'm still the pill. okay, so we don't have. Do you have a picture of Gainsburger? Can you just put it up there? I think it'd be so funny just to come up with that.
Yeah. Hold on, let me find it.
All right,
it's going to take me a minute. I didn't Google it.
Let's see if Anthony showed up yet.
It's just dog food.
Yeah, but it looked. It was a very strange.
It was like it was
looked
kind
like
of
a hamburger patty.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, Anthony, I don't see you in here anywhere. For those of you who are in the audience now, if you raise your hand.
He's having a hard time downloading the app at the hospital, okay. So just chill.
I will. If you raise your hand, I will try to bring you up onto the podium here to chat. But if you do raise your hand, you are consenting to coming on these.
There's your Gainsburger. It's $13.92.
That's the current version of it. That's today's.
Yeah, it was kind of this weird. Why did we feed our dog that?
Yeah.
I remember it smelled terrible. It smelled
that's
like
meaty
tires.
Burger.
No, it was. Well, same thing.
Different. It's different because those were the Gainsburger were literally patties.
Okay, let me try it.
Those of you who raise your hand, you are consenting to come on this YouTube.
Maybe
Twitch
they don't make it anymore.
Stream. No, they don't make it anymore. They don't make it anymore. Wikipedia. Go to Gainsburger Wikipedia.
There it is.
There it is. Oh, this is good. Soap and water. Here we go. We're watching an ad for Clubhouse.
For all the things you've had to share without a single complaint. For all those things. I'm glad they've made your Gainsburgers with more real meat.
Real meat. See it? That's the Gainsburger. There it is.
Now it tastes even better. With the real
I wonder if we're violating some YouTube
right
policy. Just so don't put
right,
it up
let
anymore.
Turn it off.
Yeah.
Shit.
It won't stop.
I'm trying.
Okay, there we go. All right, so I'm going to look for see who wants to come on up here. This is
my high tech
Carrie.
Abilities are kind of not very good today.
Let's see, Carrie. Oh, he didn't come up. Oh, there he is. Hey, Carrie, what's going on? Carrie.
Hi, Dr. Drew.
Hey, buddy.
Yes,
what's happening?
Can you hear me?
I hear you.
Awesome. I also remember you from Adam days on K-Rock, and actually my for some reason the strongest memory I have is the day you guys had Phyllis Diller on the show.
That was Poor Man.
And she made it.
That was Poor Man.
Was
and,
that the Poor Man?
That was Poor Man, and Eagle was gone by then.
Swedish Eagle.
I would say, yeah.
No, and she made it like one break, and she's like, guys, I can't do this.
She said, I thought this was a funny show. Bye.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah.
So, I'm sorry to digress.
Yeah.
I just wanted to pick your brain, or even if you have comment on this, I am a volunteer court appointment special advocate, they call us CASAs in LA County, with foster youth, and in particular, I work with a foster youth who's 14, and I am constantly pushing for trauma therapy for these kids who, in his case, he's been in the system about 5 years. He has been through 25 25 placements, which means he's moved 25 times in 5 years. And as they move in and out of placements, sometimes to group facilities or out of the county, they change mental health providers. I know in his case, in the last year, he's changed 4 times.
Was he ever at Hillsides?
I do not know. I have not been his advocate that whole time.
Okay, because that's the best place I know of for this kind of kid. I mean, it's specifically designed for this, but I don't know. Getting him in, it's always full, that kind of stuff. So
Hillsides
Home for Children. Yeah,
go to hillsides.org.
Hillsides.org. Yeah, I will
look for it.
Been working for them a long time and with them a long time, and they're about as good as gets. They really are. They're very good.
There's this tremendous gap between quality mental health care for these kids and their ability to acquire it. And I don't think there's any kids that are more vulnerable and need that kind of trauma-informed therapy more than, you know,
100%.
Hillsides.org.
100%. And they end up on the streets after they're ill-served during their adolescence. And if they're lucky enough,
tell
not
them
to
that get, they keep them into their 20s, like they
yeah
help
they have
them
a halfway house too that they help them transition out if they're willing to stay, and so they do the full spectrum. They educate, they treat the trauma,
they help them get jobs, they help them get it really homes, is, they help them take care of their lives.
The hard part is getting in, I'm sure.
Well,
but it's very good. It's very good. And
awesome.
So that's what I'd strongly recommend. But yes, of course they're traumatized. I mean, my God, there's sort of no worse trauma than what they go through. And, you know, there's some schools, I heard Crenshaw is like 60% of the school is foster kids. And one social worker comes there one day a week or something, or one school nurse. This is insanity. We're heading towards trouble with a lot of people who are in need of really serious help.
Can I plug CASA really quick?
Yeah, which CASA? Which one?
CASA of LA County. 35,000 foster kids in LA County. If you have the time and you have the interest and desire to help a foster kid one-on-one, please do contact them.
Let me shine a little, put a little lantern on that, hang a lantern on that, and just say that some of the research shows, particularly if you can get them around age 8 to 12, a single positive relationship sustained outside of the home has something like a 50% chance of changing everything. Would you agree with me?
Absolutely.
All right, buddy.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the
Thanks,
work.
Andrew.
All right. Oof.
These are good questions.
They're not just good; they're extraordinary, and they're asked by extraordinary folks who are doing extraordinary things. So, very, very impressed. If you know a bunch of carries out there, an army of carries could make a big difference. Okay, I'm not seeing any other hands up.
Anthony's having a hard time. I think he got my Dr. Drew TV mixed up with Dr. Drew. I'm Dr. Drew TV. You're Dr. Drew. So he may have gone to my thing and I wasn't doing anything.
So how long have we been going for, would you say?
You've been talking for 48 minutes and 47 seconds.
All right, because I have to go in about 10 minutes or so.
Okay,
so.
You've done a great job. You've taken a lot of calls and this is working really well. I really like it. I love having Clubhouse tell them.
Yeah, Clubhouse, thank you so much for being part of that. I still feel like I have time to take one more call.
Okay, I don't think Anthony's getting in.
Okay,
so it'll
I'll
be
call
ne-
him.
Next
I'll call
time,
him.
Yeah.
I'll call him and talk about it.
But we'll get him hooked up so when you have to call on him, he can.
Well, it's also because I'm blanking on the name of the caller now. I think it was Sandra who had questions about these intermediate care facilities. So I'll see if we can maybe get Anthony in here.
This is our mental health group. I mean, this is a lot of people that are really interested in mental health questions.
Yeah, which is great. Which is
and
great.
I don't have to screen the calls.
No, I know. They're,
and write down the questions.
They're all terrific.
And I don't have to pay $35, and I don't have to pay a screener. It's all courtesy of Clubhouse. Thank you, Clubhouse.
Let me see how this works. Did I bring Clifford up? I don't know if I did.
Okay, one more and then we'll go.
So I'm looking for a raised hands here. Give me a second. Oh, there's Clifford. Let me see if I can bring him up. Clifford. Let's get him up here. Clifford?
Uh-oh, I think I started a room by accident.
Oh, another
I don't want that.
Clifford, are you there?
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, Dr. Jeans.
Hi, Jeans.
I want to plug Dr. Drew After Dark for all of the folks that missed the old K-Rock days and want to get a little bit of a same taste of the.
It's funny. It's funny you would say that. I've been talking to somebody. Well, I was talking to my son, who we were talking about what to, you know. He said to me this morning, he goes, "Well, you need to. There's a need for a love house, a love line type thing," and I said, "You know, if you look at the voice message responses I'm giving on After Dark, you know, the voicemails, that's really old school love line stuff." And so I think what we're going to do is try to cut up all those voice messages and push them out on something, TikTok or Instagram or something.
I'm not doing it.
And you'll see that that is the very Loveline-esque type of thing. But thank you for that. And if anybody's interested, go to drdrew.com. It's right there, Dr. Drew After Dark. You can click through, and it's always up. And it's really
YouTube.com, your mom's house.
It's your mom.
It might not be to everybody's taste, but it's great for even like I've got teenage nieces and nephews. It's time for them to hear about these things.
Chris, I'm working with Tom Segura's wife.
The rational revolution.
Yes, so I'm mostly with Tom Segura's wife, Christina P, who's a very smart person, a very good comedian, and she has the conversation. I don't mean heady. I mean extreme topics. She brings extreme, and so because of that, the voice messages seem relatively tame, even though they're pretty wild. So that's the love line effect right there. There's the funny and then these really significant questions that people ask, but they're couched in humor, and it's a really great community. So I really appreciate you bringing that up, Clifford.
Thanks. Awesome. Thanks, Dr. Drew. Thanks. And
keep my hand tight. I know it's what you're going to say. Keep my hand tight. So I have to wrap this thing up here. We appreciate
United had a security breach. We need to change our passwords.
United Airlines?
I'll do it.
Great. All right. So thank you, guys. Thank you, Shirley. I thank you for saying so.
Oh, guess what? Raising Hope at Hillsides raised more than $470,000this week.
Maybe they should never have their...
We got 170 on top of the 300 we had going in, and I want to thank anybody who contributed to it.
So it's going to be guys like who we talked to here, the CASA, you know, the guy who wants to bring his that poor kid in. You're helping kids like that. That's what you did. You $170,000. Will sustain several children
for a long period of time. We did it virtually, too. We didn't even have to buy a dress and shoes and do hair and makeup. Oh, my God, I saved so much money. But I bought Dr. Stout's package, and I contributed. So, and then somebody's going to stay at our beach house. So I get to do that. Anyways, yes, you have to do some spots for Gary. And what was I checking my email list for? I can't remember.
All right. Well, thank you on Clubhouse. I'm going to leave the room here. We do appreciate you guys being a part of this.
Steve Kirsch wants to know if Dr. Oz mentioned fluvoxamine.
I did mention flu. He didn't. I did. All right. I don't know quite how to end a room. I guess it's just leaving. So that's what I'll do.
Say goodbye to them first.
All right. So we leave the room. And then
I was trying to get the latest After Dark banner. I think
it's actually with me and Nadav. So
it's Nadav this week.
Yeah, we have one of our. There's a whole cast of characters over there at your mom's house, and some of them. The routine is me and Christina P, but some other ones show up periodically. So it's
Nadav. I was gonna get Josh Flagg today, but he couldn't do it. He wants to come next week. He sent this funny poster, and it said, "Okay, ready?
Yeah."
It says, imagine living in a nation where Cardi B's WAP wins Song of the Year, yet the Cat in the Hat is deemed inappropriate content and Disney slaps content warnings on The Muppet Show.
Yes, we're all upside down and inside out. However, you probably can't find them anymore because the books have all been taken after off the shelf. I am not
for censoring books. I had all these videos, too, that I got rid of.
But you should take a look at poor Dr. Seuss's drawings. Not okay for
listen. A lot of that was sexual. Bugs Bunny. I had a whole bunch of Bugs Bunny videos I gave away. Finally, I just had for years and years. But I used to laugh my ass off when the kids were little babies because it was just funny. It kept me entertained while they watched cartoons.
But the Cat in the Hat, not the Cat in the Hat.
That's why they're all screwed up.
Particularly the Asian images and the African American images were just not okay.
That's not good.
They were not okay. And I understand. At first, I was incredulous. I thought, oh my God, I can't believe we're doing this. We're burning the books. And then I saw the pictures. And then I was like, okay, I understand. Look at the pictures.
Cardi B is pretty. I understand. You know, she's everybody's favorite. These little kids love her.
It doesn't take away from the fact that things are upside down and inside out. Absolutely. The point of Josh's little poster there is well taken.
I know. We're going to have him on next week, hopefully.
But if you're doubting what they're doing with those books, I still don't think the books should be taken away. I think you shouldn't buy them. I think not all of his books, just those particular ones with these images were way off.
Can we erase our entire history of life? Like, this is what we grew up with. This is it. This is why we're all so screwed up.
I don't know. That could be. Okay. Well, anyway, thank you all for being here. Thank you for being out of the chat. Susan, are we going to do anything across the weekend?
I don't know.
We don't know. We might not. But probably Monday probably we'll be not. Back.
No, I don't know. You've got stuff going on. We'll see.
All right. Thank
we
you.
We did
all
a
for
lot of
here.
Shows this week, thank and you I to want Clubhouse. You to go back through the catalog and catch up.
All right. And I think we are heading towards better days with COVID. It looks looking pretty good. I do not want that variant. Thank you very much. So, all right, you guys. We'll see you either across the weekend or Monday or Tuesday.
I am so grateful for our friends at Blue Microphones. Not only have they completely changed what our show sounds like, they've given me headphones so I can monitor things better. This is the mic for millions of creative people, and now I know why. I'm so grateful for them completely changing the quality of our audio. You'll find Blue mics like Yeti and the Mouse, which we're using here, both in pro studios and home studios, literally all over the world. Their popular Yeti Caster is a Blue Yeti microphone, plus a boom arm system that's behind many of your favorite podcasts. I run into them all the time, and now I know why. If you've ever thought about creating your own podcast or YouTube channel, Blue can make you sound and look great. Just visit bluemic.com and click Get Started, and you can start telling your story.
Real talk.
Headlines have become sickening. They become poisonous.
Dissecting headlines.
Defying state orders. Sheriff Bianco not enforcing what the governor is saying.
Dialed in with decision makers.
Clarify what you actually meant.
Get the answers you need.
Beginning of this, we were told don't wear a mask. Is this really helping?
Expect a different kind of newscast. Fox 11 News Special Report. Weeknights at 7.